This painting that we are currently looking at is the original painting is about 40 by 48 inches. It's an oil painting. In fact, it's the first oil painting that I ever did in my life, and it was in August of 1977. Before I get into the details of this painting, just a quick little background. My art career actually began when I was about 12 years old, when I won a citywide contest for art, and my subject was a colorful little drawing I did of Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck. This was in 1956. And I felt pretty good about myself back then. Growing up, I found that I had a gift for drawing faces. And I sort of parlayed that when I was in college from 61 to 65. I began as an art major and then switched to art history. I would help pay my expenses by drawing pencil or black and white portraits for my friends. Either they were sports oriented or they were pictures of their girlfriends. And back then, I would charge $5 a piece. Then there was this one anecdote where one of the drawings I did was a pencil drawing of the heavyweight champ at the time. His name was Sonny Liston. And he was kind of a mean looking guy. And I'd actually basically copied it off of a photo on Sports Illustrated magazine. I had an entrepreneurial roommate who back then was a business major. And in the 60s, people that were business majors were sort of like unacceptable to us liberal college students in Massachusetts. However, he discovered a thing called the Xerox machine, and we went into business. He made copies of this, and the original I never sold, but we would sell these little prints for $2. And back then you had dormitories that were pretty much like prison cells. They were all concrete walls. So the freshman dorm that I was in, there were a lot of pictures of Sonny Liston. Anyway, to fast forward, I continued doing portraits, but I actually had a real job. And then finally in 1977, I had gotten out of the business world for a while, and I lived in this little town called Newburyport, Massachusetts, which was sort of an art colony. And at the time I had been divorced, and I had the opportunity to buy this house, and I had a studio in the house. And I thought a lot about what I wanted to paint. Back then I was a huge music fan. In my generation it was Elvis and the Beatles. And an interesting thing happened in August, not interesting, it's sad, but in August of 77, Elvis died. And that was pretty upsetting to a lot of us that were fans. But I had a Beatles album, the Sgt. Pepper album, and I used to play that quite a bit. And one time, just listening to the music, I was looking at the centerfold of the album, and it had these four images, and I had never done that before. I had only done, in the 20 years to doing portraits, at that point, I'd only done single faces. So to me, this was a challenge to do four images, and I got this big old canvas, and I started working on it. My goal was to sort of get the images in sort of a Rembrandt style. Back then, I thought I knew a little bit about Rembrandt. Turns out I found out later I wasn't very accurate. But my concept for his skin tones were a shade of brown, burnt sienna, some yellow, and some white. Incidentally, the original painting had a very dark background, like the old Dutch masters. It was all this burnt sienna, also burnt umber, which is a darker version of the brown. So I worked very diligently on the faces during the day, and again, I thought I got a good likeness of the four of them. And then I would end the day and have a couple of beers and go outside and take a walk. And I then would come back at night for a little while and paint those wild colors in the uniforms, which were a lot freer and a lot more fun, actually, than the discipline of the portrait. So this was essentially my first attempt at oils. And I'm very happy with the way it turned out. About a year or two after, I did change the background to this color. I kept this painting in my own private collection for years until a very good friend of mine, Brian Johnson, who happens to be the front man for AC/DC and a huge collector of my work, made me an offer for the painting, which I couldn't refuse. So the painting is now in his home in Sarasota, Florida. Doing this painting, I had an idea that I needed to sort of hone my skills. So I decided to enroll at the School of the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, Massachusetts. At the time, I had an undergraduate degree in liberal arts, and I did not apply to the MFA program. I just applied as a graduate student for studio classes. At the time, they were still are affiliated with Tufts University. And my goal then was to just do studio work. I wasn't that much interested in the academic classroom studies. So in order to get into this school, I had to pass a test, which again was portraits. And that was my skill, and I was able to get into the school. And once I was in, I was able to select other courses. So I spent 3.5 years there, primarily honing my portrait skills and also touching on landscapes and life drawing and sculpting. This painting right here is actually my final project for my second semester of portrait work. It was a self-portrait. And it's in pastels. It's interesting because most people do not work in pastels anymore. And I thought I'd really elaborate. Normally, the requirement was primarily just a basic shoulder and head shot. But I decided to do this full-blown portrait. And in my personal life, I was living in Cambridge, but I also spending a lot of time when I could on Siesta Key, Florida. So the background of this painting is sort of a sunset, and at the time I used to wear these Panama hats, and also I did have a beard, which as you can see was reddish, and several years later when it turned whitish, I got rid of it. This is a very interesting painting. I had an art gallery owner in Sarasota, Florida, subsequent to the time I painted this, to say it's one of the best actual pastels he's ever seen, and one of the reasons not too many do it anymore. But the whole painting is pastels, and it's very large. It's 30 by 70. You can see the blending of the clothes, the skin, but the primary skin tones. If you mentioned, I was talking about the Rembrandt. Now, I began to develop my own style, which you use a lot of reds and other yellows, magentas, and the skin can be a lot of different, even some greens. So I had a lot of fun doing this particular drawing, and it wasn't easy. And it's a little messy in pastels because it's essentially a chalk. So when you're working on it, you really have to wear one of the masks that become popular in the last few months. Anyway, I did this in the early 80s, and I got me through to my next session at the museum school. However, during this time, which was the second semester, I traveled to Asia. And the teacher at the time said he would give me credit if I did portraits while I was over there. So I took my sketchbook and I did a lot of portraits. But this painting now that's up there is an oil. To me, it's one of the most haunting paintings I've ever seen. This was done in 1986, 87. This woman was in Chiang Mai, Thailand. I was with some friends and we had flown up to Chiang Mai from Bangkok. It's the second oldest city and it's a beautiful little village. And at the time, I saw this woman who was homeless and I began to sketch her. The interesting thing in Asia, at least in Thailand,
at least what I was told, is if you do an image of a person, you have to give that image to them. Otherwise, you've stolen their spirit and they won't get into heaven. So what I did is I did two very quick sketches. One I gave to her and one I took home. Now I showed this to my teacher and he thought it was fascinating. He asked me if I could develop more into an oil portrait. And that's what I did. This painting, to me, is still one of the best portraits I've ever seen. I mean, that I've ever done. It's haunting. It's something, I have kept it, but it's something that is very difficult to have hanging in your house.
I hadn't done a portrait in several years, and when I was working on these street scenes in my studio on Siesta Key, Florida, I decided to go back to my roots, and I had a couple of sketches of this character. His name is Duncan Chase, was Duncan Chase, and he was a legend in the town of Newburyport, Massachusetts, where I had my original art studio back in the late 70s. And at the time, Newburyport was a restored Federalist town. They had put a lot of money in it in the early 70s, and it was a beautiful coastal town. It had actually been the first port in America, even before Boston. Not in America, but in Massachusetts. So legend had it, Duncan at the time was essentially the town drunk, but he was a very personable and very handsome man. And it turns out there was a legend that went along with him. Supposedly his family was the Chase family that was in the banking in New York, Chase Manhattan, and that he had been an offshoot in a sort of a black sheep, and supposedly a dropout from Dartmouth College in New Hampshire, somehow and became a fisherman and ended up walking the streets of Newburyport. And he was the subject of a lot of photographers and a lot of sketch artists. And at the time when I was there, I sort of refused to do that. I mean, I did a few sketches, but I refused to do a portrait because I thought it was a little, too commonplace. Everybody seemed to be doing it. And I got to know him because he would stop by my little shop and ask for a little money. And at one point he became a pain in the ass, and he was hard to get rid of. But his classic line was, if he liked you, he would call you Johnny. Because supposedly at one time in his checkered life, he had spent some time with Johnny Cash in Memphis. There was also a rumor that he was involved with some sort of a murder under the bridge in Newburyport, but I'm sure none of these stories were really true. But at any rate, so 20 years later, when I was in Florida and working on a whole different color scheme for all my paintings, basically, because as I said before, the light on the Gulf Coast of Florida can match any light in the world because I've been there. I've been to Provence, I've been to Florence, I've been to Tuscany, and I've been to New England, been to Asia. The light is very special. It's a combination of the sky and the water and the constant change. Because anytime you watch the sunset, you'll see about every color in the rainbow, and this reflects in the sky and in the water, but it also reflected in me and my artwork. So when you take a look at this painting, you'll notice the golden yellows, and yellow started to become one of my favorite colors to work with when I was in Siesta Key. And according to a lot of art history stories and about painters, particularly impressionist, yellow is a very difficult color to work with. But I began to develop a technique where it's not just yellow. If you look at this painting, there's a base of yellow, but there's different shades of yellow, and there's also mixtures with red and even some some light brown, some greens, but it's a sort of a secret. But this painting definitely captured the personality of Duncan Chase, and more so, I think, the technically, it's one of maybe my best portrait, because I not just concentrated on the face, the hair is totally free, you know, wind blown. He certainly looks like the fisherman that he was at one time. The coat, the shirt, the sweater. There's a lot of work in this. And again, I began to develop a background taste of scents, actually, of my favorite colors, which are violet and golden yellow. And these came into force more in the decades after that when I was in Tuscany. Viola is one of the most prominent colors, and in fact, it's the color of the Florence team, soccer team. Anyway, again, this painting was, in my opinion, and many other people's opinion, my best portrait, and it was purchased by John and Mary Louise Toll, who are avid collectors of my work.